Get ready, guys. Big time singles matches coming up here.
And I can assure you, these two superstars have been waiting all day to get their hands on each other.
What's this?
Well, I think it's about to be a highlight reel.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, it's Sunny Sapphire, and immediately the diamond cutter by Vinny Jones on the notorious AKO, and Vinny Jones is flipping off everybody in this crowd today.
Like, just like the last time we saw him, he's just flipping off everyone, but he seems to get more intense with flipping people off every time I see him.
Yeah, and another, the new and improved diamond cutter. And now the camera gets off in his face. This is a PG company, goddammit. Don't flip everybody off. And now a dropkick right to the back of the AKO, the notorious one. But he is notoriously getting beat down at this moment, Ed.
It continues on. Every time he does a move, he flips him off. He doesn't move, he flips him off. He doesn't move, he flips the crowd off. And a huge frog splash by the big man.
And he flips us off. And goes for the pin. One, two, and three. And just like that, Vinny Jones disposes of the notorious AKO in probably the fastest and quickest opening match that I've ever seen on a pay-per-view.
Yeah, this was incredible. I don't know what to say. I mean, you could say AKO was still making his entrance and he got attacked from behind. But this is dominant. This is dominant by Vinny Jones. This is absolute dominance. He's showing that he is a new top star in the making.
Yeah, Vinny Jones is not taking any prisoners tonight. as we are going to continue on. But oh, Vinnie Jones is going to continue on as well. And
no.
Well, yes.
Okay. Sonny, yes. He's going to move, and he's going to flip us off.
No, he already flipped
him
off.
He flipped him off again.
Getting out of hand, like BG. No, we're not BG. We can't be BG. Not with Vin Jones around, or with Rhino Top Day, for that matter.
Yeah, it's incredible. I think I know that Vinnie Jones has gone through quite the changes ever since he departed from the Brotherhood. But this is insane. He's trying to seriously injure AKO.
AKO is still standing. I don't
AKO
know how
is still standing. He's flipping us off. And he flips us off again. And here we go. We are going to transition to our next match, which will be for the UCW Hardcore Championship. It's Lewis Taylor challenging Jiraiya, the UCW Hardcore Champion, at. And this is going to be incredible. Let's take it to ringside.
The following contest is a last man standing match and is for the Hardcore Championship. Introducing the challenger from out of this world, weighing in at 260 pounds, Lewis Taylor.
All right, we're back with the second match for the UCW Hardcore Championship, and it's going to be a last man standing match.
I just want to say, I think people in UCW keep evolving, keep transforming. I mean, maybe we're the Transformers, I don't know. But Lewis Taylor looks like a completely different human being altogether. No, I wouldn't even call him human. I mean, his hair is glowing white.
Yeah, it's like he's shiny or something. It's really weird.
I don't know what's going on.
Maybe
UCW.
Maybe this is something unique that only Lewis Taylor can bring to the table. This is only the second biggest match of his career. Like, he had that match last time on. on the global domination, and we all know what happened. We all know the controversy.
Yeah, there was a lot of controversy with the lights just going out of nowhere.
Yeah, but also we don't know what just we don't know what happened. We don't know if the referee was paid off or not. So we only know that from what we saw, Jiraiya getting a two count and the referee saying it was free. And ever since that moment, we've been trying to figure out exactly what happened. And we still don't know.
Yeah, no, we're still none the wiser.
Yeah, so that's in my opinion, is kind of upsetting because in some ways it implies that Jiraiya has a bigger connection to maybe the referees than we know about at this point, Ed. And that could be
well, not only the
difference
referees,
maker.
I mean, the referee cannot shut off the lights. Can he? Does he have a remote? Maybe he has a remote, I don't know.
Well, I don't know about that, but the only thing I know is that what happened shouldn't have happened. And now we're here, last man standing match, to make sure that there is no more controversy concerning the hardcore title.
And you think, just because it becomes a last man standing match, there's just not going to be any controversy? I mean, we're talking about the emo princess, or prince, whatever, Jiraiya here, and Lewis Taylor, the maniac, I wouldn't even know what to call him, and a referee that apparently was paid off last time, or at least it's possible.
Well, there are circumstances, but we don't know, so we can't really be certain about that. But what we can be certain about is that this will be a last man standing match. And as I said, the controversy, the chances of it being a controversial finish are less than a normal hardcore match.
Or the referee is just going to count really fast, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
We can immediately, then we can immediately see that something isn't right. And with the 2 and the 3 count, we weren't sure because the lights went out and then...
I know, but maybe his response is, I just did cocaine.
Speed, you mean?
Oh, no, it could also be cocaine. It could also just pump people up. But yeah, speed as well. I've no history with drugs, by the way. Just clear.
But we need to make this as clean as possible. Even though that's really difficult with somebody who cuts himself. You know, it's impossible for it to be clean. Yes. And right now, the referee is at a 7 count, Ed. Already a 7 count. There's 8. And now Jiraiya is showing signs of life. But Lewis Taylor is dominating Jiraiya in the early going, Ed. So who do you think has the advantage in a last man standing match? The unpredictability of Lewis Taylor, could that be an advantage for him?
Yes and no, because just like you like said a moment ago, Jiraiya cuts himself, herself. I mean, you just get confused by these emos. So they lose a lot of blood. But they keep on standing for some reason. They keep on being alive. So with all the blood that Jiraiya lost, doesn't even matter. How do you like that explanation? I love it.
That's incredible, Ed. I mean, I mean, sometimes, like I think 95% of the time, I forget why we actually hired you to be a commentator. And then there are moments like this where I think to myself, oh, that's why he should be a commentator. And then the rest of the pay-per-view, you don't say anything significant at all. But you know.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah, that's probably the story of your life, right? You probably said 2 or 3 things to get Janie into bed. Now you have a child, you're married, but you don't actually
so
have a good relationship.
She cannot run away any longer!
She is not getting away from you! Alimony! Alimony!
I'm not gonna pay alimony.
Because
we're happily married. You're happily married, so I don't need to pay alimony, yeah.
Well, again, the 8 count, and again, exactly at 8, is when Jiraiya started to make movements, and that's the difficulty that Jiraiya is facing at this moment, Ed.
Yeah, but now Hulk signs of life with a nice. Oh, nice move.
Yes, and now Ayush whips him into the swinging neckbreaker. Very nicely done. Takes him over. And just like that, Jiraiya is asserting dominance in this match. And
flying
then,
Evo.
Yeah, there he goes again.
See, you find it difficult. Evos just look like your girl. I cannot explain it any other way. It just looks like girls.
Well, that's not exactly what I am saying, but the long hair does kind of throw me off, and every time I hear emo, I immediately think of a woman. So, sorry about that. I'm so sorry, but that's just the way it is at this moment.
I think everybody is doing things the same, so it's fine.
Oh, great. That's great to hear. And now Jiraiya has Lewis Taylor down, and the referee has started his count. He's up to three at this point right now. Three. And it is noteworthy to see.
Do you think he counts three times?
Well, then you're at nine. And he's not Pippi Langkous, so.
Pippi Langstauken.
Langstauken, yeah.
Yeah. Well, now again, going for the count, three count. And a four, it seems Jiraiya is having some difficulties again, but the eight count is gone. Haven't you noticed? The eight count is gone. It's just getting up around four or five now. So, a second wind of life for Jiraiya.
Yeah, a shot of adrenaline is flowing through his system right now, Ed, and that's about it with a beautiful short enziguri to the back of the side of the head of Lewis Taylor, and now a discus forearm, and Jiraiya is taking control, and he is not letting Lewis Taylor catch his breath, and that's a very smart move. You need to do as much damage in as much time as possible. And with a power bomb, very nicely done. So, how would you have you ever been in a last man standing match? Yet?
No, I've never been in a last man standing match. I've been in countless of matches and different types, but never a last man standing match. So I don't know how you prepare for it. I don't know if you come out the same.
But looking at the base of what a last man standing match is, what do you think is the best strategy to use as a wrestler, as a competitor?
To try and just keep them down by attacking the legs. Attack the legs over and over again so they cannot stand, because it's all about getting on your feet again. And if you can't stand, it's over.
That's true. And that's the importance of this match. And it's also for the newest title in UCW, the UCW Hardcore Championship. And Jiraiya is still having a dominant reign with the championship. He is the longest reigning champion. And it's not just because of the fact that this is the shortest championship in existence of UCW. The amount of days that Jiraiya has had that belt are over 100. And now he spears Lewis Taylor right to the left side of the barricade, right into the UCW fans, and they are having the time of their lives.
Yeah, this is what they paid their hard-earned money for, to see these guys absolutely brutalize each other. Because that, what I said about just breaking the legs and keeping them off their feet, it's not about that for them. They want to hurt their opponent. They hate each other so damn much. It's just about ending them.
Yeah, it's about asserting dominance, but it's also about making sure that they are the top dog in the hardcore division. And that is what Jiraiya has been for over 115 days at this point, Ed.
That was close.
That was very close, but Jiraiya, smart, immediately getting up there with the enziguri, but the second one is into a German suplex by Lewis Taylor. And you can see that's Chuck Jiraiya, because he is having trouble getting up to his feet, using the rope to gain leverage.
Oh my god, catching Jiraiya midair. God,
that is incredible. What a backbreaker. And Jiraiya showing signs of life immediately, not not staying down, Ed. He is not staying down.
No, she is indeed not staying down. And another time, a German with the leg trapped.
Yeah, immediately. And that is some kind of a fisherman German suplex. And this has been an incredible match so far, Ed. This has been incredible. And we have seen a couple instances where we have gone through the 8 count, but we haven't seen that for a little while now.
No, that was only a 1 count just going up straight away. He's playing with him now. Lou Steyer is now looking for something big.
But Jiraiya is having none of it with an inside heel kick. Very nicely done by Jiraiya. And now will the hardcore stipulation finally come into play here. The last man standing stipulation. Jiraiya with a chair tries to do it to the abdomen. And now right to the face. Right to the face, Ed. And now the chair shots raining down on Lewis Taylor. It looks like a twisted heap.
Keeping him down at all counts.
Oh, the schoolboy super kick, and Jiraiya is feeding it. Look at him go, Ed. He knows he's in
trouble. Look at him go, indeed, thinking it's a goddamn moss pit in here. Now going for the kiss by the emo,
right to the back of the head, stomping it down into the mat. And
that's
what
gotta be
will
it.
Happen now? Will Jiraiya be able to put Lewis Taylor away? The referee has started his count, Ed. Keep your eye on this one. And Jiraiya going to the top rope. The emo.
Yeah.
The emo signaling that he has won the match. He probably thinks that he has won. He is already celebrating, Ed. He's already celebrating.
Wait,
at the last moment, Lewis Taylor at 9. Got up, and now Lou Fresh Press and raining down the punches on Jiraiya. And that is something Jiraiya did not see coming at, and for good reason, might I add.
Yeah, because Kiss of the Emo is usually the end. It's the end because you've been kissed by an emo, you know how toxic that is. You know how much hairspray
you
use over their whole dead body.
You are not getting up from that. It's something you shouldn't even want to get up from. You can just bury your head in shame and just pray that the gay goes away. And, you know, that's not
are you
really
calling emos gay now?
No.
Well, it did sound like
no,
that.
It rhymed, okay? It rhymed.
Now again, going to the top row. This time, going for elbow drop. Is that going to be enough to keep this lunatic down?
Well, I think that it's what Jiraiya is hoping, but this time he is not taking any more chances, Ed. Bringing the steel steps into the rope, and we saw last pay-per-view with Global Domination, we saw what those steps can do and how badly they can hurt one. So, what is going to happen this time?
Well, I think the exact same is going to happen here. Steel just merging its body with. It's painful to watch. At some point, the referee may want
to think about stopping this one before somebody. Yeah, it really is. It really is. And at this point, you gotta wonder how much is the UCW Hardcore Championship worth for you if this is what you have to go through to get it. I mean, at one point, it is to demonstrate to everybody what this championship is worth. But is this the amount of punishment you want to go through to get that championship, Ed?
Well, that's why it's the Hardcore Championship. It's only for the competitors that can get that hardcore to begin with. Jiraiya again, this time looking for a moonsault, perfectly executed.
Yeah, congratulations to Jiraiya because he is dominating this match. And if I'm gonna be honest with you, Ed, at this point I don't see how Lewis Taylor is ever going to make a comeback.
No, it looks like this is a done deal, and now with 2 steel steps in the ring.
Yeah, but now Lewis Taylor showing some signs of life with a and there he goes, spinning side slam, but there wasn't much after that, and Jiraiya showing it by immediately getting up.
Yeah, Luis Taylor really needs to hit the big moves. But oh, big knee to the face, busting him open, I believe.
And now another chair shot, right to the face. And we can't even see if Luis Taylor is bleeding because he has red face paint. So, and now the powerbomb position. And are we going to see something? Oh, just right on the side of that steel steps, Ed. Just, this is becoming more brutal by the minute, Ed.
Yeah, but not ending there with another chair shot. Just continuing the punishment. Now, no, you cannot continue with this. But you do anyway. I mean, I cannot stop them.
Yeah, you aren't the only one who can't stop them, man. I can't stop this match. They wanted. They wanted the last man standing match. And that is exactly what we gave them. And now it is up to us to really just stand here and hope for the best. Because that's the only thing we can do at this point. We can only hope for the safety of the competitors. But if I'm looking at this match, I don't see any safety in it, Ed. I don't see any safety in it at all.
I'm not sure if Luis Taylor even is going to have a career after this, because he's been brutalized. But still, he gets up every single time. What is this man made of? Metal? Oh, we're going to go for it another time. Kiss by Nemo. That's got to be it. This has got to be it. Oh, and Jiraiya just kicking the referee.
Yeah, and the referee is counting again and again and again. And somewhere I have enormous respect for Luis Taylor. And Luis Taylor, oh, the German, and just throws Jiraiya. He just threw Jiraiya off the middle turnbuckle, Ed. What is happening? What is happening?
How can this man still stand?
I am not sure why this man is not on his last legs. I am not sure what is happening here, Ed. I just can't, Ed. What is this match?
I don't know either. Jiraiya has been dominating for the last couple of minutes, and it doesn't matter. Oh, and a referee now knocked down.
And now the referee, but it doesn't matter because the referee couldn't stop the match anyway. He couldn't DQ, couldn't count out, he couldn't referee stoppages. It's only pinfall. Only if someone stays down for 10 seconds or more, of course. But a minimum of 10 seconds that you don't move, that you are not on both of your feet, will get you the victory. I think we're about to see a high-risk move from the top rope. This is becoming more and more brutal. And again, a top rope elbow drop. And I mean, props to Luis Taylor, Ed. Props to Luis Taylor for his resiliency. But
yeah, that's what he is showing, this complete resiliency. I mean, two kisses by an emo and it wasn't enough.
No.
Maybe going for a third one, I don't know. Now, schoolboy into the super kick.
And again, it seems like...
At this point, it's just... I don't know. I don't know what you need to do to keep this man down. Let the ref do his job.
This is not the place where you want to under- Well, you aren't the only one who is thinking to himself, what does one need to do to get Luis Taylor down? And Luis Taylor now has Jiraiya down, and we are going to see a replay of that pump handle slam. Very nicely done. Uh-oh. Here we go.
Not over yet. And getting up at two.
Yeah, again. And now we see Jiraiya, and it is becoming more and more difficult for him as well to get up. And we are at 4 right now, at a 4 count. Now we're at 5. We're halfway there for Lewis Taylor. 6! 6 at 7! Will Lewis Taylor do the unthinkable?
No!
No, Jiraiya getting up at 7. And now moves out of the way, but Lewis Taylor isn't having none of it. And now Lewis Taylor running in with the forearm. And you see that Lewis Taylor is showing more signs of life than I could ever held imaginable from him at this point.
Yeah, I don't know where he gets this from, but this is insane. This is just insanity.
Yeah, well, insanity. Well, there is someone who says that sanity will give you freedom. So at this point, Lewis Taylor is all but free, Ed. And he has had some words about sanity. He says that he is the one who says that he is sanity.
Yeah, he wore the mask and everything, so... I'm not sure it's even possible. I don't know. I mean, Stephen Bass also wore the mask of... I think it's the anonymous mask.
The one from
V4 Vendetta.
Yeah, and now Jiraiya with Lewis Taylor on the announce table. And now the Falcon Arrow right through our announce table, right in front of us, Ed. Let's take another
look at that. This gotta be it. I don't know what else you can do to keep that man down. This has to be it. Back in the ring now.
Yeah, Jiraiya is on the top rope. He is waiting patiently to see if Lewis Taylor is going to get up. We're at 6 at this point. 7, 8.
This has
9. And oh!
Why?
Oh, what does Jiraiya do? Why would you jump? He would have stayed down, Jiraiya. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you?
What's
look at
wrong?
That. Look at that. We're at 4.
Been the end.
We're at 4. We're at 5. And will this catastrophic mistake be the end of Jiraiya's record-setting UCW Hardcore Championship title reign? No. At 8.
No.
Again at 8, Jiraiya is showing signs of life. But this could have been the most dramatic exit of a championship reign we've seen in quite some time.
Yeah, that was just a dumb decision. I don't know why you would do that. Not at this point in the match. You could have won it with that move.
Yeah, the Enziguri and Lewis Taylor just jumps up. He just feels no pain at this point, Ed. What is wrong with this man?
I don't know. I think my earlier comments about him being made of metal could be true. I don't know. Maybe this is the Wolverine come to life.
Yeah, maybe his
anything
skull,
can be possible at this point.
Maybe his skull is filled with adamantium because he isn't listening to anything we have been saying the whole night. And now Jiraiya with the sledgehammer. Sledgehammer right to the skull and right to the side of the face. And Jiraiya has made sure that Lewis Taylor is down. And again, the referee is counting down. He is counting. And will this be enough? We're at 7 at this point. Now we're going to get to 8. And again, Lewis Taylor is getting up. And now a jab to the jaw. And now a kick, but blocked. And now an inside heel kick. Again, every time Lewis Taylor tries to get some offense in, Jiraiya cuts him down. Jiraiya is in full control.
Yeah, he really is. He's been in control since almost half of this match. I think he even just... 75% of it in another.
Oh, there we go. There we go. Another kiss by an emo. Another kiss by an emo. We're going to see a replay. A replay from the kiss of an emo once again. And the referee needs to start counting. And he has started the count once again. And we're at 2.
Is that going to be the last replay here tonight? For this last man standing match.
Well, there is a high chance that this will be enough. We're at 6 already. 7.
7.
8.
Not getting up by 8.
There's some leg movement. 9! And there he is! Again!
God.
Just like it's nothing! It's nothing to Lewis Taylor. He is getting up each and every time, Ed.
This is unbelievable. There is nothing that I can say anymore about this. This is just... It's insane. It is indeed insanity. And I know that sanity will give you freedom or whatever the hell he says. But this... Does this look as like freedom?
I don't know. I don't know the philosophy behind sanity. I don't know what his thought process is. I don't know even who it is. I don't know if it's Lewis. I don't know if it's Stefan. But what I do know is that sanity at this point is not something that Lewis has, because he would have chosen freedom over the punishment that he is receiving from Jiraiya if he was a smart guy. And he just doesn't want
Jiraiya
that. And now again, pump pedal slam right on the sledgehammer. Right on the sledgehammer, on the back of the head. The hardest part of the sledgehammer. And
this is unreal.
This could be a knockout blow. This could be a knockout blow, Ed. And now Lewis Taylor. He is just patiently waiting to see if Jiraiya is going to get up. We're at 5 at this point. 5. Now we're going towards 6. And at 7, Jiraiya is going up again. And now Lewis Taylor. Oh, with a snap back suplex. Very nicely done. And Jiraiya immediately gets up. Just like Lewis Taylor. And oh! The springboard crossbody on the referee. And now the referee is out. Who is going to count? Who is going to count? Ed, should I go there? Should I go and count?
No, you don't go there. No.
I'm an impartial referee, Ed.
No, I don't believe you could be impartial to save your life.
What's my alliance with Jiraiya or Lewis Taylor then?
You have weird alliance with everybody, like Jack Harvey, who I'm gonna meet later tonight. It looks like a twisted heat.
When this guy's on, look out. I think that's partial. I think that's
How is that harsh?
I don't see any reason for you to be this harsh to me. And now a drop toe hold by Lewis Taylor. Has Jiraiya hanging on the middle rope. And there he goes, the 619. The 619 by Lewis Taylor.
I didn't even know he had that in his arsenal.
Nobody did. And now the missile dropkick by Jiraiya getting out of the way. It's very smart by Jiraiya. Now the teal chair right to the back of the head. And what is Jiraiya thinking? What is Jiraiya thinking? He must be thinking, what do I need to do to get that final second? To get that final, and now another chair shot to the head when Lewis Taylor tried to get up and immediately swatted down by Jiraiya like a fly, Ed. And now, will this be enough? We see a little bit of movement from Lewis Taylor. But will he be able to get up? We're at the halfway point. We're now at 6, Ed. Will this be enough?
We're at eight,
and again Lewis Taylor gets up, and immediately Jiraiya with the chair shot to the back of the head.
And what is this?
I don't know what this is. This is the most incredible last man standing match that I've ever seen, and the most the biggest wall against pain that I've ever seen from a human being.
Every time Lewis Taylor gets up, a chair shot to the head. And just continue the chair shot, but that means the referee needs to start the count from 1 every single time.
And now Lewis Taylor is groggy. What is Jiraiya going to do here? And there he goes, and a kiss of an emo! The third kiss of an emo in this match, Ed.
The fourth even.
It's having more...
Yeah, you're going to lose count.
It's getting up to the sequels of the Marine at this point.
As long as the referee doesn't lose count, it's fine.
Well, we're at 6 now, and after four deadly kisses of an emo, 4 stomps right into the back of the head, we're at 8, we're at 9, there is no movement! This is it! Jiraiya, the 10 count, and Jiraiya retains his UCW Hardcore Championship. Yeah.
We have one-on-one action on the way, and this one should be nothing short of amazing.
I don't doubt that for a moment, Michael. In fact, I would go so far as to say this match might just steal the show.
All right, here we go. It's at Ultimo Stars versus Jack Harvey. The best wrestler in the world versus the worst of the wrestlers in the world. It's Ed and Jack Harvey.
Undoubtedly going to give us a show here.
And now immediately the clothesline by Ed, like he's trying to make a statement here by beating up Jack Harvey right in front of me and the Top Gun Hero. A very good high flying move here by Ed Ultimo. And he is taking control early on of Jack Harvey. But I know for sure that Jack Harvey is going to take control of this match. And now a DDT on the floor. That is nothing for Jack Harvey. Jack Harvey will just eat it up and swallow it.
He's been gambling quite a bit here tonight.
It's what Jack Harvey is made
for. That goes along with being outside the ring as much as he has been. But
now Jack Harvey throws Ed in the middle of the ring. Because that is why this match has that in the ring. That's why Ed Harvey is looking outside because he's afraid to lose to Jack Harvey. Now Ed with a drop kick right to the back of the head. I should say Irish whip. It is not a clothesline. And now another Irish whip. And another drop kick, but this time, the second time around, Jack was able to dodge it. And now Jack Harvey throws Ed onto the apron. And now Jack Harvey is going to do some punishment of his own with a DDT right on the apron. Spikes him up. Like a DDT on the floor is what Ed does, and Jack retorts with a DDT on the apron. And now face first goes Ed into the apron once again. And of course, this match is because Ed is having trouble with my general manager skills. He thinks that he can do a better job. And hey, he thinks that Jack Harvey is just
some punishment in wrestling
to be a bigger
it
head
just goes
the
along with the
top. But that's not what's going to happen, because Jack Harvey is going to earn his way to the top of the mountain.
Still a lot more
and
fight
he
left.
Is going to do that at the expense of Ed Ultimo. And after Ed loses here tonight, he is going to hear this for the rest of the night. He's going to hear how he was beaten by Jack Harvey. And now an arm drop. Very nice takeover done by Ed. Gotta give him props for something. And now a super kick, but the super kick was dodged by Jack Harvey. And now a kick to the stomach. And what is Jack Harvey thinking here?
Got the leg.
Jack Harvey with a dragon screw. An inverted dragon screw. Right on Ed Ultimo. And now a kick to the chest. And Ed Ultimo is feeling the punishment. He is feeling the punishment that Jack Harvey is bringing here tonight. And now Ed with a Irish whip into the corner.
Vicious attack.
And now a splash right to the midsection. Following it up, goes back to it. But Jack Harvey catches him with an Irish whip of his own. And now a drop kick right to the back. But Ed, what a kip up! Ed is just saying, no, this is not going to hurt me, Jack. And I mean, he follows up with a German suplex. Very nice.
So much
big resilience showing here by Ed Ultimo.
And he took out much to nobody's surprise. Hey, I guess you never know.
Not even waiting. He's doing his down right in front of Jack Harvey. And Jack Harvey follows up with a double underhook suplex. Very nicely done by Jack Harvey.
What a stomp!
And now Jack Harvey with a stomp to the back of Jack of Ed Ultimo Stars. And now working on both of the arms. An arm breaker. Very nice, Jack. Very nice. That is what you do. That is what you're the best at, Jack.
Now this isn't
and now Jack
right.
Harvey with the first official pinfall. Legs on the ropes. And a two count, and Ed is able
just
to
needs to do more damage. Got the leg.
And now another dragon screw. And this time on the other leg. And Jack Harvey is showing the dominance. He is showing what he is able to bring.
It doesn't get much better than this.
And this is why Ed shouldn't have stepped up to Jack Harvey. This is why Jack Harvey and I are such good friends. It's because I can count on him. And now the schoolboy, immediately a kick out because he's way too close to the ropes. and now a kick to the stomach by Ed. And I don't know why Ed thinks that I'm such a bad general manager. I do everything right.
Perhaps
I make
match
cards,
to do next
I make
here.
Matches
oh,
in general. I put on the best pay-per-views that UCW has ever seen. And Famous Last Words is another great example because it's been great so far. And now I'm going to see the most electrifying move in Ed's entertainment. There he goes, the standing moonsault. Very nicely done by Ed into the cover. One, two, and three. Oh my God, no, that was a fast count. That was a fast count. Referee, come here. This is a fast count. This is unacceptable.
And here's a look back at some of the action from the previous match.
This was another great moment. The next match. Maybe I'm going to restart this one.
Almost forgot about this one.
This shouldn't happen.
from Munich, Germany, weighing in at 500 pounds, he is the Lucha Champion, Johnny the Body Ricci.
Byron, if there's been a more highly anticipated triple threat match in recent memory, I can't recall it.
Me neither, Michael. Given the three competitors involved here, I think it's safe to say that heading in, this is among the most eagerly anticipated triple threat matches in recent memory.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back as Ultimo has joined the commentary booth once again. And it's time for the Triple Threat UCW Legends Championship match. Johnny Riddle is the current champion, and we have challengers in Dark X. Why is he still a part of the following? Ed, please give me some sort of reasoning.
I have no reasoning. I have no reasoning at all. And they're both going after Johnny Riddle.
Yeah, immediately. And TJ Youngblood, even though he has... we can clearly say that he has some kind or some way a bad relationship with Dark X and Johnny Riddle.
Yeah, so I don't understand the thing about this, but the whole following has been weird since they started. I mean, they kicked each other if they lost, but still, they were in the same group. It was a weird initiation system, and all kinds of just strange things, but I guess that's what happens in a sect. But I just want to say something, Sonny. Did you see that beautiful moonsault for the people to defeat Jack Harvey? Oh, it was so beautiful. It was fantastic. I know you loved it. I know you loved it. I know you shouted at the referee saying, "Good job, referee! Good job, there was a clean count. It was not fast, it was just a normal count." I heard it all. Don't go shy on me now.
Well, if you knew me like you say you do, then you know that I think that this is an atrocity.
No, you think it's beautiful. You think it's fabulous.
No, I don't.
You think it's the most sunny thing that ever happened at UCW. It's so sunny.
No, I'm disappointed in Jack Harvey, but I know that he did his best, and I know that the referee fucked up in that free count. That should have been a one. I saw the shoulders going up of Jack Harvey.
Jack Harvey was just done. He was finished. He wasn't good enough.
This is what injustice looks like. But at this moment, we saw a 2-on-1 on Johnny Riddle, but Johnny Riddle is the powerhouse of the following, and that he is for a reason, and he is just manhandling the both of them. But now a DDT by TJ Youngblood.
You gotta think that the trucker hat on top of Riddle's head is giving him all his power. And if somebody touches the trucker hat, well, he's just gonna get more powerful as time goes on. Now, this has been a message by the Bridge series that the leader really likes. So, here you have it. Now you can finally shut up about it. He has a trucker hat.
Well, that indeed he has, and that is not something that any of us are trying to dispute at this point.
No. And the bait. What was TJ Youngblood doing? Why was he hitting air?
I'm not quite sure, but he has, with quite a couple baseball shots on Johnny Riddle. Johnny Riddle being able to kick out at 2. Very smart move, actually, by TJ Youngblood to make sure that Dark X was also down so he could administrate the count. Ed. So I think that's...
the problem with a baseball bat, too. Oh, small package.
Small package.
Referee doesn't
small
know
package.
What to do.
1, 2... Oh, just in the nick of time. Just in the nick of time. God, that was probably the closest that TJ Youngblood has ever gotten to a UCW championship.
And it's not even an official one.
Well, this is one of the few times it's actually been defended.
I know. It's just the thing Justin created because he couldn't get a real title.
Well, he is the television championship, but...
He is the television championship. Are you making the same mistakes as dumbass in different productions? He is the television champion. He's not a championship. Or do you think he identifies himself as a championship?
Do you think... I mean, there's been a lot of talk about TJ Youngblood and his actions, and... Do you think that this might be the time for TJ Youngblood to finally start winning a championship?
It's the best time. There's no time like the present. But the problem is, how are you going to keep the big man down? Because this man, Johnny Riddle, could be in the hardcore competition because he takes the shots and he stands back up.
Yeah, that's very true, but he is not. Look at this! Dark X and TJ Youngblood are raining down with baseball shots and chair shots on Johnny Riddle. They are forcing him to stay down.
This is what I'm talking about! Again, he is up on his feet. He could be in the Hardcore Championship matches.
Yeah, he is showing incredible
strength. TJ Youngblood going for a pin now.
And now TJ Youngblood going for his first championship! Johnny Riddle kicks out at two, and he kicks out with authority. This was not a small kick out.
No, it was with ease. Now Dark X trying... I don't even know why Dark X wants this. What is his reasoning? What is his... And he apparently also has a problem with hitting air. Maybe they see ghosts. Maybe Justin is like doing something in his basement, and he's doing something with the sects. Maybe calling demons in UCW. I mean, we haven't... It's not the first time that we see demons here, so...
That's true. Now Dark X with a splash right to.
That was a concerto, but with the body. Bodyetto? Yeah, that was real bad, I know.
Yeah, I'm not even gonna say anything about that, but we see a pump handle into the facebuster, and Johnny Riddle's down. Johnny Riddle is down, ladies and gentlemen. Johnny Riddle is down, Dark X is down, TJ Youngblood is in control, and deadlift sit out powerbomb!
Johnny Riddle, what you doing?
Oh, and Dark X just able to get that shoulder up, and I'm not sure what Johnny Riddle was doing, but he wasn't paying attention to his championship, and it almost went away, and now he rolls out of the ring.
Small package!
One, two! Oh my god! No!
TJ Youngblood!
No!
That's a
TJ Youngblood! Oh my god! TJ Youngblood has won the UCW Legends Championship! And pinch me! Pinch me at!
The man that always complains about wanting championship matches actually won a championship for once.
The man that only comes around when a championship opportunity is in his future.
What the hell is going on?
This is probably the longest stage that TJ Youngblood has ever had in UCW. He hasn't left for over 2 weeks. It must have been excruciating pain for him not to leave immediately after.
And now he leaves the stage because he's the champion.
He is the champion, Ed. What is going through your mind as this is happening?
I don't know. I Does Johnny Riddle even care?
I'm not sure, but he wasn't able to break it up.
No, he wasn't able to break it up, but he was the most powerful man in this match. Of course he was. But Dark X just... We don't know his motivations, but he lost due to a small package for TJ Youngblood.
Well, we are going to say congratulations, TJ Youngblood. I guess
you have won.
He doesn't even want his hand raised. He doesn't even want his hand raised. We are going to compose ourselves, and we'll be right back.
came to see tonight.
And with good reason, Michael. This one's been brewing for quite some time. The atmosphere inside this arena for this one is absolutely insane, guys. And if you think this is insane, just wait until this thing kicks into high gear. You ain't seen nothing yet.
This match is sure to not disappoint, especially considering who's involved here tonight.
You're absolutely right, Michael. This match will be one we'll be talking about for a long time to come.
We'll be right back. here we go, and it sounds to me like the crowd is more than ready for this one.
So am I, Michael. I've been looking forward to this match for a long, long time.
I am perfection. I am perfection. I am perfection. I am perfection. Yeah.
Alright, here we go. A fatal four-way tornado tag team match for the UCW Tag Team Championships. We have the Charismatic and Cool Connection, represented by Sander Cool and Arthur Stein. We have the Alliance, represented by Dave Williams and Mike Hansen, because those are the only two people in the Alliance. And we have the DDS, represented by Jeroen Mercury and Barnes Reed. And then last but not least in any way, we have the champions, the Brotherhood, consisting of Aiden Zinda and Jerome Holland.
And we have Ed almost falling asleep because that took an eternity for them all to get inside the ring.
Oh, that's just what it is, Ed. That's not really something we can do about that.
I know.
It is an incredible match.
What is this? What is this? Sander and Arthur? What?
Ed, have you been paying attention? No,
I've
sorry,
been
I have not
kinda,
been paying attention.
Like, raiding and whatever, you know, I was facing somebody, so I didn't really pay attention to Sander. I also don't really care about Sander, so I wouldn't pay attention to Sander either way.
Well, and now you're complaining, but there's nothing for you to complain about, because there is no reason for anyone to be like
I just this. Don't understand how somebody would align himself with Sander. That's all that I'm saying. I mean, why would you align with the biggest joke in UCW history?
Well, I don't think that is how this person sees it, but I can understand your frustration, your obliviousness to the whole thing.
And the same is, why the hell is Mike Hansen still aligning himself? Okay, but you know what? Sorry. The biggest joke in UCW history is, of course, Dave Williams. I'm sorry, Sander. I'm sorry. You're not the biggest joke any longer.
Ouch.
It is Dave Williams.
Oh, Dave is going to cry.
I mean, that's what he always does, doesn't he?
Well, you've been a big supporter of Dave in the past. So
it was all a lie. It was all...
For what, though? For what?
To give him some hope in his pathetic little life. To give him hope that somebody actually likes him. That somebody is actually a fan of his non-existent abilities, pretty much. You know, I gave him hope, and he was so happy with it. Every single time, he was so happy with it. And I destroyed that hope at his lowest point. It was all a plan, and I loved every single second of it. And yeah, that may seem really, really mean to a lot of people, and that's understandable, but hey, I had to do what I had to do.
Well, that's, I think in a way that could be understood, but it's not something that I can understand at this point. But we see Alexis' submission on Jerome Holland by Jerome Mercury and Dave Williams coming up to break that up.
Knocking them both down.
And he knocks them both down, and now Aiden Zinda comes back into the ring, as is Barnes Reed, who is targeting Jerome Holland. And now... It seems like this is a clusterfuck as I've ever seen one at. Eight people in this match. Eight people and the referee. So there's a total of
nine.
Now
we've seen eight people in the match before. It's in ladder match. And those are already chaos. But this time we also have the referee. So that makes it nine. I mean, I would almost say that the referee is a part of the match. That he's also a competitor. Maybe he's going to be the new tag team champions. I would like to see that, to be honest. I mean, they don't get paid a lot, so having a little bit of a pay rise, just becoming a champion, it's something they deserve.
Yeah, I feel the same way. I feel the same way. There's a lot that could still happen here in the referees, but, you know, what do you do about it? I mean, I could do something about it, but...
Yes, you could, because you are the president or whatever the hell you want to call yourself, the owner of
the general manager of UCW.
Yeah, and the general manager, and I mean, what else are you?
I'm a lot.
Yeah, that's one way to put it.
Are you?
As Aiden Zinda now hit Sander Cool down, and the only Well, no, never mind. I mean, I wanted to say the only people in the ring, and all of a sudden, there's Dave Williams. There it is. You know, Mercury. This is chaos, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to be difficult. And Arthur Stein with a huge moonsault into the...
Oh, and a double pin, and both been broken up by members of the Brotherhood. Aiden Zinder broke up the other one, and Jerome broke up the other one. So... It seems like for now, oh, and a big boot by Mike Hansen sends Aiden to the outside. Jerome has also been sent to the outside, and everyone except for the champions are in the ring right now. And now Aiden Zinder has been thrown back into the ring by Mike Hansen. It seems like he really wants to pin the champions to win the titles. So how do you feel about the general consensus of the Brotherhood ever since winning the tag team titles, Ed?
Well, they sure got more of an edge towards them. They're just like, you know, we're gonna accept all this hate. We're gonna accept it and just throw it right back to all of you that denied our greatness for so long. That's the point that they are at now. And you know, they have a little bit of a problem with Vinnie Jones, for example.
Yes.
That's not a little problem, by the way, because we saw how he absolutely demolished AKO earlier in the night. So it's not a small problem. It's a big, big problem ever since he changed his ways. Like, he's become a completely different man. And the Brotherhood as well. They're just accepting the hate and trying to make something out of it.
You know,
they are
two times like that, yeah.
Because we cannot deny the fact that Connor and Marcus Fenix won the tag team championships. Although it wasn't for that long, and it was all just some plot by you. Still.
Whoa. I did nothing of the sorts. I only did what had to be done.
Yeah, you said like, oh yeah, Vinnie Jones, just pay attention to the match. Pay close attention. You know? You gave him the key, pretty much.
Vinnie? No.
No. And how about saying stuff to AK-47 Q?
Think it's admirable that you think that someone like Vinnie Jones is going to be controlled by me.
Well, don't you say that you're controlling Mason and that is the most uncontrollable
I
man in the roster?
I said that he was like a puppet.
That's
never control Dylan because he's not able to be controlled, but I know what strings to pull to get him to do something. That's what I said. So don't twist my words. Because after the whole ordeal between myself and Dylan went and was gone, I never did anything to Dylan again.
No, not to Dylan, but to other competitors. You sure did.
But that's not the one you were talking about, right? You were talking about Dylan.
No, I was just saying, and everybody almost is down. Only Sander, Aiden's in the Artestine, but there is Dave Williams all as well. It's difficult to commentate a match with so much chaos. You just have to look and enjoy. Can you even enjoy it?
No, I can. I think it's difficult for you, but I can.
Well, you haven't said anything in the last couple of minutes. It's just me talking.
Yeah, but sometimes people
so
need to
focused.
Hear your voice. Well, I am.
No,
I'm very
focused.
I am looking at this match. I am seeing the Brotherhood having difficulty with these three teams. I'm seeing a very nice Michinoku driver by Mike Hansen. I'm seeing Dave Williams standing down, stamping on the lifeless body of Sander Cool, like he did when he was US champion. But there's a lot of past rivalries and a lot of existing fire that is in this match. We have Sander and Dave. We have Jerome and Mike Hansen. We have the Brotherhood against everybody else in this tornado tag. And now an enziguri by Barnes Reed sends Archer to the outside and throwing in with the Hurricane Rana on the floor as Dave Williams and Sander Cool are brawling on the outside of the ring as well. And Dave is just throwing Sander Cool around. And now Jerome Holland with Archer Stein in his hands. What's he going to do? And he drops Archer on the barricade. And now it's only three people in the ring. It's Dave Williams
who's going to receive
the Clash of Mercury. And he throws them around. Will this be enough for the tag team titles to go back to DDS? No! And just in the nick of time.
Did you see that among the chaos, nobody saw what would happen to Dave Williams?
But we just saw a black arrow by Barnes Reed. And now the on Sander Cool and Archer just in to save his
tag team partner helping him.
Well, that's what a tag team partner should be doing, Ed.
Yeah, I know. That's what a tag team partner should do. Yeah.
So they are the most inexperienced team. And I think at this point, the Brotherhood is probably the most experienced team in this match.
Yeah, because you can't really call, you know, Mercury and Barnes Reed an experienced team.
No, they had a match in the main event of Power Struggle this week against Sander and Archer. And they lost. Yeah. Sander rolled up the DDS and he got the victory. It is a roll up, so it's a controversial victory, but he did get the 1-2-3 nonetheless. He was able to keep DDS down for the free count with his incredible roll up. And now we see that Barnes Reed is probably bleeding from under his mask because we see some blood on his chest. Now Sander rolls out of the ring.
It could be blood from anybody in this match.
Yeah, it could be blood from anybody, but we are going to say that it's probably...
Hey, it's either a combination and a knee strike straight to the face, so if it wasn't busted open, it is now.
Yeah, and Aiden Zinder is taking control of this matchup all by himself. No Jerome Holland inside, jawbreaker by Mike Hansen. And now Mike Hansen, with the Irish whip, throws Aiden Zinder to the apron. And now is he going to suplex him back into the ring? Yes, he does! Very beautiful suplex. Very nicely done by Mike Hansen. Now Mike Hansen and Dave Williams are singling in on Jerome Holland. And now Dave with attention to Aiden. And Mike. Mercury. Oh, and now Sander comes in Mercury with the backbreaker, neckbreaker combo. And a double axe handle by Jerome Mercury on Archer. And now Sander with the flatliner on Aiden Zinder. And now jawbreaker by Jerome Holland on Mike Hansen.
We all know what Sander needs to go for. What did I call this last month? It wasn't last month. It was a different pass.
Last month. A week and a half ago.
Yeah, a week and a half ago. What did I call it? What does he need to go for?
The final flash?
No. Flashpoint.
Flashpoint. Well, it seems like, and there was a submission attempt by Aiden Zinder, but Mike Hansen was able to break it up so that Barnes Reed wouldn't submit.
I mean, the final flash has nothing to do with the Flash. But no, that is Vegeta's.
It's a cool
move.
Name.
It is a cool name. Of course it is. But Sander just flattened Dave Williams to the ground. And now chaos among everybody once again.
Congratulations, everybody who is still with us here tonight at Famous Last Words.
Why are you congratulating them?
Incredible. I mean, it has been a long pay-per-view. There has been a couple of instances where...
But we have still so much to go. This isn't the end.
We have still a lot more action to come, including the World Heavyweight Championship that will be inside Hell in a Cell at a triple threat match, the stipulation chosen by AK-47 Heel.
Yeah, that is going to be something indeed. Can Connor overcome all odds? Or will somebody else take the spotlight?
Well, that is what they are going to attempt to do. And of course, we still have Dela Mason versus Azrael inside Steel Cage. We still have the European Championship.
Probably the most lucky to be at this very moment is Mason and Azrael.
When this guy's on,
that stuff is going on. I don't know. I really don't understand. But... Oh, another type of no, pile driver.
Sit out, pile driver. There it is.
This match has been all over the ring, all over the ring, all over outside of the ring, and now a deadlift, gut wrench, suplex. Into a power bomb sit out version by Jerome Murphy and Superior Bronze Reed to Dave Williams. And there's a lot of history, and again, a hurt. Very nicely done. Of course, we know the history between Bronze Reed and Dave Williams.
Takedown right there.
We know there's a lot of hate still there.
Exactly. And now the only four competitors inside the ring. Impact. Archer Stein just rolled out.
Jerome Murphy is rolling out. And it's Jerome and Sander. But Sander is rolling to the apron.
This could mean the end of this match because there's only two people. But no, nothing bad.
Oh, springboard DDT. DDT on Sander. And now it's Aiden Zinda.
Facebook
is alone in the ring with Mike Hansen. And this could potentially mean
it's moves like that
that
make him so dangerous.
Is going to be over.
He's too quick.
What are we going to see? The jumping knee missed. Aiden Zinda
down hard.
Rolled out of the way. And now a deep six. Deep six by Aiden Zinda.
Oh, and it seems like the back of Sander just broke down after a clothesline.
I think we know what this is. That's what he was looking for, Michael. Ooh, what impact.
And now, the pin on Mike Hansen. One, two, nobody's breaking it up. Yes. The Brotherhood have retained. Nobody was breaking it up. So many people in the ring, but nobody was noticing that the Brotherhood was actually
pinning Mike
Hansen.
Now's a good time to look at some of the highlights
and
from that last matchup.
Have retained their tag team titles here tonight.
Against all odds, once again, the Brotherhood remains the tag team champions.
Yeah, but we've seen a lot of here. We've seen a lot in this match.
I really enjoyed every minute of this.
And again, this was a clusterfuck, and we are going to be back in a couple of minutes. But congratulations to the Brotherhood for retaining their tag.
Here are your winners, and still the tag team Aiden Zinda and Jerome Holland, the Brotherhood.
What a back-and-forth battle that was.
That's a big win right there. Anytime you can pin another WWE competitor's shoulders to the mat for the three count, you should be proud.
And I can imagine there aren't too many people at home regretting tuning in for that amazing match. Wow.
Superstars ready to square off here.
And there's nothing quite like seeing two superstars settling it in the ring in one-on-one action, Michael.
We'll be right back.
this will be one you won't soon forget.
Totally agree, Michael. If you had two superstars as hungry as these two competing in the ring, you can bet it'll be memorable.
Yeah, we're back, ladies and gentlemen.
Singles
and we just saw the Brotherhood retaining their championship.
What's going to happen.
And now it's time to find out
anything. Sometimes
it's going against
do.
Them.
And man,
next
I
week.
Never get tired of watching
week.
These guys
next.
Compete.
Because this is for the number one contendership. Either
Whoa,
Bill
right
is going to earn a championship opportunity for the following, or Galki is going to earn a championship opportunity for the Sweet Beautiful Sunshine.
So who would you like to see win?
That's not what he had planned.
Well,
I would hope not,
I
Michael.
I think that I would most likely want the Sweet Beautiful Sunshines to win. I think the contrast with the Brotherhood and the Sweet Beautiful Sunshines would make
for a
more
bomb.
Compelling matchup.
And that's not a good place to be, Cole. Into the powerbomb position.
I have to
And that's
agree
not
on me,
necessarily where you want to be at this point in the match.
You gotta believe this one's over.
Yeah, I'm friends with the Sweet Beautiful Sunshines, and I think it's their time. And I hope
go.
That
back inside the ring.
Dolphin can win here tonight. The
He's
same
got to hurry
as,
if he doesn't want to get counted out here.
Time's
here
certainly
tonight.
Not on his side, Michael.
Well, yeah, you weren't the only one who's hoping that.
But... Are you hoping that as well?
In a way, yes.
Uh-oh, no, don't do this. I got right to the gut!
Yeah, this story that they have is quite complicated, I don't know.
Oh, there is a lot of, I'm not sure if we should call it complicated. I think it's actually pretty to the point. Bill has a way of expressing himself that is never going to be alright with most of the population. And Galki is someone who has been vocal about his displeasure against the comments that Bill is making. That is something that is 100% clear to everyone.
Yeah.
And Bill has also seemed to forget that he also went against him in the semi-finals of the King of the Ring this summer, where Galki was able to pick up the victory as Bill kicks out at one from the first cover of the match.
Yeah, but we both know that Bill is deranged, man. I mean, he says he becomes a better version of himself, so he's version 2.0. I don't know what he is now, maybe version 2.5. No idea. So maybe he just forgets his past versions? Like it's like an upgrade, like there's a new chip inside of his head.
I don't know. I don't know how that works, as we see a double stomp by Bill Nemeth. But he has been uncharacteristically quiet about this whole match, Ed. He hasn't really said much about it. But this is a match with pretty big implications. Because if you win this, there might be UCW Tag Team Gold in your future.
And that is something that everybody
oh,
wants.
Oh, the Darkness Demise! Out of nowhere, the Darkness Demise! And the road break, Bill didn't take the time to get Galki into the middle of the ring where he could pin him with no worries about a road break. But Bill is on his way to maybe...
And the knees were up for the moonsault. Very nicely saw.
Yeah, he is. Galki isn't really trying to deteriorate from this match. He is still pretty much in control.
Yeah, he is in control. I mean, it seems like the Darkness Demise is just shaken off. And again, we have Galki just dominating this match. And a rope break, this time actually putting their hands on the ropes.
Nailed it. This is exactly how he drew this one up. What a stomp. Good grief.
And flipping him.
Yeah, Gelke keeps flipping him with a monkey flip assisted arm drag.
I mean, it's better than flipping people off.
Big elbow.
He's just flipping. Flipping Bill.
It just doesn't seem to be his night tonight, guys. For a while there, it looked like he was going to take this match. It's amazing.
Now going for the pin. Is that going to be enough? And one and a half counts. It's getting close, though. I don't know. Bill has indeed been really quiet, although Bill usually just talks, and constantly just, you know, he finds everyone bad, pathetic, and disgrace, and all these guys. And another darkness device.
Another darkness device, and this time going for the cover. And a kick out by Gelke, a pretty immediate kick out.
And one. Not even one.
But Bill doesn't seem deterred from this.
No, he doesn't seem to care. I mean, you should care. That's your biggest move in your arsenal, and twice is not enough to keep this man down.
Looks like a power bomb coming up.
And now a running sit-out power bomb. And Gelke is really feeling the punishment at this point. Going for the cover. One, two, and a kick out by Gelke at two this time, Ed. So the counts are getting longer for Gelke. There is more difficulty for him to kick out each and every second.
That is quite apparent indeed, and a nice
exploder suplex into the corner by Bill Nemeth. And now another third! The third Darkness Demise, and this time we're going to see a replay. There it is, ladies and gentlemen, that devastating Darkness Demise kick from Bill Nemeth. But Bill is taking his sweet time to cover, and this could come and bite him in the ass. One. And two, and a kick out!
That was a one count.
Was it a one count? I thought it was a two count.
Well, what is this?
And a jumping knee strike by Bill Nemeth. And it seems like he can't keep Gelke down. It seems like something in Gelke is burning brighter than the darkness that Bill Nemeth is bringing to this match. And now Gelke, the shiny one, is going to the top rope, and a top rope elbow drop.
The shiny one.
And now the headbutt, the Glasgow Kiss headbutt that Gelke has used so much. And now he's raining down punches on the face of Bill Nemeth. He's being punched in, and now a jumping knee strike by Bill Nemeth. And it seems like the small moves are gone, only big moves in this match, Ed.
It seems to me that the loss to Mason has burned something inside of Gelke, and he's just not letting up. He wants this more than anything.
Yeah, that is true. That's adamant. That is something that you can't deny.
Now he's going to go for it.
He is tuning it up. The life lesson! Oh! And Bill Nemeth! Bill Nemeth dodged the life lesson! Bill Nemeth dodged the life lesson. He did learn something from the last encounter. The small package! One!
The small package!
And a kick out, and almost
Bill
Nemeth.
It's been so successful here tonight, the small package.
It's one of the most devastating moves in all of wrestling. The small package, followed by the inside cradle, and at number three, the Okada roll.
And if you really want to go crazy, the bridge.
If you want to get a pinfall, use a cradle. If you want to,
you can
get a pinball, use
a cradle. He's going to go for it again.
And
this
here
time.
Comes the lesson. The live lesson. And Gelke hits it on his face. One, two, and three. And Gelke Shine is able to get off Bill Nemeth. And that means he got off Bill Nemeth. He made sure that Bill isn't in his rearview mirror anymore. That's not nasty. That is what happened. And that means that the three beautiful sunshines have a tag team opportunity in the future.
It is time. It is about time for them to get some tag team gold. I've been a fan since I've ever seen them beginning, they first tagged. They're not even in UCW and other companies where they first came to tag team. You know, they deserve this more than anything.
Well, I think this is very nice of you, and we're going to go to a break. We're going to come right back with our next match. Congratulations, Gaoki, and that means that the SBS will have a tag team opportunity.
Nobody knows where the rivers flow, and I call it home. I wanna see the rainbow high in the sky. I wanna see you and me on a bird flying away. Your smile every night and day. I wanna see the rainbow high in the sky. I wanna see you and me on a bird flying away. And then I hope to see your smile every night and day.
if I didn't mention, and it's
all right, here we go, a triple threat ladder match, Ed, and I'm going to give the mic to you. You have expertise in ladder matches. How is this going to work? You see what's happening. Rainbow is leading the pack. Like a true wolf, everyone is following him. Look at this. Look at Rainbow. Wesley and Kota Matsuda are following in the Rainbow's footsteps. This is incredible.
That is what the Godfather
Look at that.
Of my kid
They are
does.
Trying to get closer to him, but he is extending his lead. What a wolf pack. What a leader.
What a wolf
What's
pack
What's happening
indeed.
Here?
Kota is done with it, though. He's now... No, no, wait.
Doesn't seem like
and
they are interested in winning this match.
Follow the leader, leader, leader,
follow the leader. Follow the leader, leader,
follow the leader, 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 follow the leader. Oh, wait.
And now Rainbow,
we're finally gonna do something.
The flying forearm on Wesley Walker, and follows it up with a sliced bread number one. And
Wesley Walker countering
it. In control, enziguri by Wesley Walker. Now Wesley Walker with a kick to the stomach.
Is
he going
go
to
for?
Walk the ropes? Yes, he's going to walk the ropes into a very nice arm drag. And now this triple threat match has finally begun, and now we are going to look at that and ask his opinion on this ladder match.
Yeah, and I want to say it's really mean to ask me a question about ladder matches, because everybody knows that my biggest nemesis in all of pro wrestling history, in all of my career, is the ladder match, because I always lose in the damn ladder matches. I've had 3 or 4 so far, and I cannot seem to get the win in a ladder match. I'm just saying, it's emotional for me, a ladder match. It's an emotional, like, I don't know. But yeah, this is the match, of course, that Rainbow Wolf is spectacular in. He's won Chasey, of course, he won Chasey in a ladder match. And he defended it in the match with me.
And he defended it against Iron Bison in the ladder match as well. But Kota has his hands on Chasey. And you see the aggressiveness of Rainbow Wolf immediately when somebody touched his Chasey.
Yeah, I know how aggressive he can be when you touch Casey. It's not a fun experience. You think it's all fun and games with the Rainbow Wolf, but if you touch Casey, oof, you gotta feel some pain.
Well, we are seeing, we just saw Rainbow hit a flapjack on Wesley Walker. And is he going? No, he's waiting for Wesley to get on the ladder. He is just, he's inviting Wesley to get on the ladder, Ed. And Wesley is winning! Wesley is winning! Wesley has his hands on Chasey, Ed. He has his hands on Chasey. And is he going to get... oh my god, he is.
But we
he
all
is slowly
know
unhooking
how
the briefcase.
It is
the most difficult thing in sports entertainment. It's almost as difficult as countering a small package. It's something that takes years and years of training, and we saw that you haven't mastered this craft yet. But we have seen Rainbow, who has a longer, more experience in ladder matches.
It's almost as difficult
and now the
as Dave Williams actually being successful. Ha! Look at
well,
that.
Well, that is a nice burn, but it fails in comparison that he has a longer title reign than you ever had in your life, and probably
Stop!
Ever will have. No, I'm not stopping. This is reality, bitch. This is what we do at UCW. I'm throwing your face into reality.
I always live in reality. It's you that dreams.
I dream of a world. I have a dream.
No, stop. Just stop. What
that,
is Rainbow Wolf doing?
That
He's going
Ultimate
insane.
Stars might have been taken seriously at one point. I have a dream.
I mean, that actually happened, so. I mean, I just...
When?
I just...
For how long? 15 seconds? And now Kota Matsuda is on the ladder! And Wesley Walker!
How
Wesley Walker
this
picked
is.
Up the Rainbows!
Wesley is there! Can you imagine Wesley Walker with Casey? I cannot imagine it.
I'm not sure if Rainbow is ready for a divorce. And now Rainbow with Wesley Walker into the double on the hook, into the double knees. And Kota Matsuda reviving himself and again has his hands on Chasey. And it's this time, it's the glorious one who's trying to make sure that Rainbow Wolf stays the Chase the Case holder. And now Rainbow is climbing, but Wesley Walker is back
Wesley
on his feet.
Is also,
and now immediately Wesley Walker is trying to make sure that Rainbow isn't getting Chasey
and
back.
And this is what happens in a ladder match.
Especially when there's more than two people involved. And now a devastating lariat
by
Rainbow. And now Rainbow going to the top of the ladder.
All alone, and he knows how to do this.
He is
he
the
knows
master.
How to do this.
The master.
Well, apparently he forgot how to do this.
No, there it goes. He is unhooked. There it is. Rainbow Wolf unhooks Chasey again. And look at that. Look at his face, Ed. Look at his face.
He's so happy. He's so happy that Chasey is still his wife, his possession.
And we are going to be right back. Look at that. The Rainbow in the Case is still of Rainbow Wolf. And we are going to be right back with our next match.
Everybody's building empires, building walls high in the name of glory. Everybody's hanging high wires, it's a fine line, it's an age-old story. The first will be last, and the last will be kings. The small will be great, and the great will be weak. Everybody's building empires, but it's our time. This is a kingdom. Blessed are the bound and broken, you're a citizen, and your faith will prove it. Blessed are the persecuted and the wounded, you'll be crowned as rulers. The first will be last, and the last will be kings. The small will be great, and the great will be weak. This is a kingdom. Forever.
They don't say God's changed my ways. Changed my ways. There's evil ways. So I set out across that way to strike them down, to make them pay. Change their ways, their evil ways. But I can't.
Into this world all alone. God takes your soul, you're on your own. The crow flies straight, a perfect line on the devil's back until you die.
Yeah, here we go. Six-man tag team action. On the right, we have the team consisting of John Dreamfield, Johnny Crow, and Matrix. And on the left, we have the team right now represented by Diego's with Justin and Stefan Bezen meeting in Hurricane Rana by the former World Heavyweight Champion John Dreamfield. And Ed, what do you think of these three makeup teams?
Johnny, I have some popcorn for you. Johnny, I have some popcorn. I just had to say that I have some popcorn for you.
Guys, I think someone has popcorn. Can he finish the job?
Yep. The force of that impact should put an I mean, you know how important right that is for Johnny Crow. Yeah, these teams, it's weird. And what's weird is on the left side, we of course have the following leader, Justin. We have Stephen Bass and we have Dirgos. Now, Stephen Bass has proclaimed he is sanity, he is the man, he is freedom.
Yes.
And Dirgos has been really against sanity and his key to freedom. So that these two guys team up with a guy that is pretty much leading a sect.
A cult.
Sect, whatever you want to call it. I find that a really makeshift team. And on the other side, you have Johnny Crow, the man that loves popcorn, recently returned. You have former World Heavyweight Champion John Greenfield. And you have the former tag team partner of Dirgos. And that team, I can understand a bit more.
So who do you think has the advantage? Because if I hear your explanation, I think the team of John and Matrix would have the advantage. Because of the fact that they have worked together before this, especially Johnny Crow and John Dreamfield.
And they don't have different
There actually have been a lot of rumors speculating around Johnny and John that they might actually become a tag team.
Well, I would say yes to those rumors. Do it. Both great competitors, and you never know what can become of a newly made tag team. I mean, look what I've done with Rainbow.
Yes.
He became the
Oh, and Diego's is signaling for it on Johnny Crow. What us? Oh, look at the teamwork, Ed. Look at the teamwork. They
this
are going.
Is indeed teamwork.
They are going for something so powerful. And the Crow is going to be brought back down the triple powerbomb by Johnny Crow. And now they are trying to make sure that nobody can out. And Matrix was able to get through Justin and break up the pinfall just in the nick of time, Ed. That was one of the closest near falls we've seen all night.
Yeah, that was in the nick of time. But that teamwork out of nowhere. Although these guys all have a different world view, of course, Justin wants to clean the world. And look at this! There goes Stephen Bass working together! And what a maneuver it was. I'm surprised. I'm shocked. I mean, they both all have pretty high opinions of certain people here in ECW, but they're really working together, although yeah, their worldview isn't the same. I didn't expect this. I really didn't, Sonny.
Yeah.
And a codebreaker.
A codebreaker by Stefan Bass on Johnny Crow and John Greenfield this time breaking up the pinfall. And that means
maybe
that technically Matrix and John Greenfield both have broken up a pinfall. And that's technically, if you look at the deep rules of tag team wrestling, you can break up a pinfall once in the tag team rules.
Indeed, so it depends how lenient the referee is tonight.
Yeah, it's going to be a struggle to see what the referee is going to do here. But right now, they are still following all the rules of tag team wrestling, and that is something that couldn't be said for a lot of the matches in the tag team division as of late. So, So this is great to see. Great to see. But Johnny Crow really needs to make a tag to either Matrix or John Dreamfield, because right now it's Stefan Bass in full control.
Yeah. It's surprising. It's just, I didn't expect this at all. And Johnny Crow maybe needs to go for the pin. For the tag. And looks like he's going for that. Yes, he is, and that means Matrix has entered the ring now. He's already looking for a big move.
I'm not sure how much he has left.
Nicely spinning Brainbuster. Yes, spinning Brainbuster.
This was indeed a spinning Brainbuster. And he kicks out. Just not enough damage done yet, Cole.
So what do you think of this sudden teamwork of Justin Dirgos and Stephen Bass?
That's the most surprising thing of this entire six-man tag at this point, because what you said, I pretty much agreed with that. I mean, there is some negligence to who is actually who. And now the spinning on Prettier by Matrix, a spinning on Prettier. And Stefan Bass
and he goes for the hot tag.
The tag to Justin. And Justin comes in with a cyclone kick. But the clothesline missed. And now Matrix. Oh, standing Spanish fly. Very nicely done.
Wow,
into the cover.
Nowhere.
And Justin kicks out before the count could even start, because Justin is still really fresh. Clothesline over the top rope now. And now the six-man tag is breaking down. We still see Stefan Bass recuperating on the outside. But Matrix hasn't had the same fate. He hasn't had the time to recuperate, because Justin is getting on his case. He is making sure that he stays down and that his team take away the victory tonight. So what I think is most incredible about this is, even though Stefan Bass, Dirgos and Justin have nothing in common, Justin and Dirgos have been very vocal about their displeasure of having the team together, but they do know, in a way, the importance of winning this match. It is cementing themselves as the best champions that UCW has to offer. Because losing here would open up the possibility of them having new number one contenders.
Yeah, and what number one contenders at that? I mean, look at the competition that they have.
For example, if John Dreamfield ends up pinning Dirgos, does it mean that John Dreamfield gets a championship opportunity against Dirgos?
Well, it can be any one of the three, and maybe we're even going to reignite an old flame.
Yes, well, there are lots of flames that can be reignited as. He's making a
statement here with this attack. I was specifically talking about Matrix Dirgos, but yeah, I know, there's a lot.
I know. I know. I'm not stupid.
It's Justin now using his power. Making it look easy. A real successful. And he's flipping off Johnny Crow. You don't flip off Johnny Crow. You're not
Well, he
Jones.
He just did. He just did. What are you going to do about it, Dad?
But there he is, Johnny Crow, inside the match. The power of popcorn isn't working. Judas Effect! Here he goes.
And now, Justin is going to do the call of arms.
No. You cannot do that to Johnny Crow.
Well, that's exactly what he is going to do.
Johnny, fly! Fly, Johnny, fly!
And a triple powerbomb for the second time on Johnny Crow. The first time it was instigated by Dirgos. The second time by Justin. And John Dreamfield comes flying in on his rival, Justin Alperault. And he breaks it up even before the count could start. And now the six-man tag is going out of control, Ed.
It is going out of control. Raking the eyes. The referee didn't see it, but I saw it clear as day. But that is what people like Justin Perrault do.
Something that is always important in a six-man. Well, he has certainly done his best. Ooh. And now it seems like there is some blood underneath the mask of Johnny Crow, Ed.
And now teamwork about the guys with displeasure towards each other. John Dreamfield here, former World Heavyweight Champion.
Tagged himself in And now it's time for John Dreamfield to go against Dergos. And this is a match that I would love to see at Dergos versus John Dreamfield. That could be an instant classic.
That could be an instant classic. That could main event any pay-per-view that we have in the future.
The key is to deliver the maximum amount of punishment to your opponent in the least amount of time. You
have that it indeed could. And we are going to hope for the best. But it seems like right now John Dreamfield has it under control. And Johnny Crow, you can see that he is sitting up. But
he's okay.
Does he know where he is? And there it is, the Frog Splash. The Frog Splash. And with John Dreamfield has won so many matches. And Stefan Bass. Stefan Bass coming in to break up the pinfall. And Johnny doesn't let him leave the ring without some punishment
no,
of his own.
No,
he's going
punishment.
To lock in the figure four leg lock.
Stephen Bass rolling out. Ooh, and that is the wrong corner to roll out. That's the wrong side. He's now in enemy territory. But, of course, guys like Matrix and Johnny Crow are not going to take advantage of that. They are not as bad as the other ones are.
Is he done?
Oh, asking referee if he wants to stop. Wait! Dergos just tapped out to John Dreamfield.
Oh my god! I didn't even see the tap. This is huge, Ed. Dergos has submitted to John Dreamfield.
What? I don't know what to say.
I'm sorry, I'm just speechless. Dergos has been so dominant in his championship race thus far. He has put down challenger after challenger after challenger. So I never expected him to tap out in this six-man tag. Maybe it is to not risk further injury. But what we can say is that John Dreamfield, Johnny Crow, and Matrix have picked up a victory. And this is some incredible questions. Who is going to be the next number one contender? We are going to find that out in the upcoming weeks. But for right now, we'll be right back.
Oh, Escobar season has returned.
It's been a long time. It's been a long time coming. It's life or death for me, man. But you know, there's no turning back now. This is what makes me. This is what I am.
Feel me?
You can hate me now,
QB,
but I won't stop now, cause I can't stop now.
Braveheart.
You can hate me now,
come on,
but I won't stop now, cause I can't stop now. You can hate me now, you can hate me now.
Do it now, do it now, do it now. Don't hate me. Hate the money I see, clothes that I buy, ice that I wear, flows that I try. Close your eyes, picture me rolling sixes, money folding, chickens, honeys that swollen, the riches. Not
all right, here we go, the triple threat match for the UCW European Championship. The champion at this very moment is Noah Youngblood. There you see challenger number one, Jake, and there is Eddie Charisma. And there the champion, Noah Youngblood. And here we go, triple threat match, Eddie, Jake, and Noah. And there is a lot of bad blood between Noah and Eddie, and you see that immediately because Noah immediately goes after Eddie. He doesn't even care about Jake at this point, Ed.
No, but you have to care for Jake, because Jake is a former European champion.
That's true.
I mean, he is the one that you won it from.
I know.
I'm just saying.
I know, Ed. I know. And now Eddie Charisma, La Magistral, and a kick out at two by Noah Youngblood. Noah Youngblood, he really needs to talk to a couple of people who have been hit with the devastating roll-up finisher. And now an X-Plex by Noah Youngblood, and Noah Youngblood, the champion.
Are you calling it finisher now? Are you going to
call it has finished thing? Some matches, so yes, and now double jumping knee strikes to both Eddie.
To be signed to UCW, and I want him to be called Mr. Roll-Up, and the only thing he does is rolling people up.
And
we have a Mr. Nipple, so it couldn't be that hard.
I heard Ray Austin is looking for a new gimmick. So maybe he can don the mask
who's
Mr. Roll-Up. Ray Austin.
Yeah, that would be great.
Corner uppercut by Eddie Charisma, but we need to keep looking at this match because it can be over it can be over just like that. And Noah Youngblood is now incapacitated, and now it's just Eddie trying to go for a cutter, but and now with an enziguri anyways.
And a drop kick to the back of Noah Youngblood. So how do you feel about the reign of Noah Youngblood?
I feel that it has been going very well. I think that after a dominating display against Jake Van Dyke, he has been carrying the championship quite well. But there is still this thing between him and Eddie. It hasn't healed yet. Everything that happened between him and Eddie Charisma, him injuring Eddie Charisma, him visiting Eddie Charisma in the hospital to taunt him, even though there was no way for Eddie to do something about it back then. But now he has a crossface on, and Jake able to break it up, so there's no submission, not yet. How do you feel about Noah Youngblood as champion then, Ed?
Yeah, I think he's done very well for himself. I already said when he had the European Championship match that this is a star in the making, and I didn't know it was going to be that soon, but it was, and until now he's been successful. He has been proving that he is indeed a capable European champion. But indeed, the bad blood is still there, and just like that, you have Jake on the ground, but what are you going to focus on? Eddie Charisma. And that could make the difference in this match. That could be the biggest problem for Noah Youngblood. Because Jake is not somebody to sleep on. He was a great European champion in his own right.
Yeah, and Jake has had a lot of on his own plate as well, with the whole problems consisting with him and the other two members of the Brotherhood, Aiden and Jerome. We do not know how that is going to come down. And we saw the brutal beatdown that Vinny gave AKO. We saw the brutal match that the Brotherhood had to go through. And, you know, they are still champions. And Jake is... he's being left in the dust, it seems, by the Brotherhood at this point. And there are a lot of people who have been saying, people like Azrael, people like Vinny Jones, that he should get out of the Brotherhood. And Jake is...
Well, I agree, because Jake is a good guy. He's always been a good guy. And, well, the Brotherhood aren't such great guys after all.
Well, they have tried. In their defense, they have tried. But it just hasn't helped.
Is it trying, or is it just hiding your real face? Yeah? Think about that, Sonny.
I am.
The same as you've been hiding your real face.
I have never been hiding anything. I told you time and time again why I'm doing what I'm doing, and you just brush it off as if I'm the bad guy, but I'm not. You would have done the same in my position.
What just happened to the legs of Eddie Charisma?
I do not know what happened to the... I don't know, but I feel like Noah Youngblood's focus on Eddie is trying, is probably going to bite him.
Eddie.
Because Eddie is going to do something, and Jake is letting him do it! Top rope elbow drop right through the announce table, Ed! Right in front of us, the second time tonight that our announce table has been destroyed.
Do you know how much time it costs to set it up back up again? Yes, it's a lot. I just want to sit at a table. That's all I want. Oh, but now Jake. No, is Jake going to do the same? No, countered by Eddie Charisma. And now Eddie again. No, you cannot break the second table. Don't break the second table, Eddie.
Oh, and now a pump pedal facebuster. That's what he was looking
for, Michael. Now Noah Youngblood again in the mix. Focusing his attention on Eddie Charisma. And now he wants to throw Eddie Charisma through their table. He wants to make sure that Eddie Charisma doesn't come back a second time. But he's not going to fly. He's not going to fly at all.
No, he's going to do something even more devastating. The front-facing pile driver right through the desk. And now both of the announce tables have been destroyed at the hands of Eddie Charisma and Noah Youngblood. And it seems like how much Jake has forgotten the Brotherhood. They seem to have forgotten that Jake is in this match.
What do you mean?
Well, they are so focused on one another that they aren't focusing on Jake.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, but maybe, I don't know, is Jake even in the right headspace with everything that's going on? We talked about this in his championship match first, but here, Noah Youngblood going for the pin, and a two count as Eddie Charisma kicks out, so there's still life there. But as we talked about it in, what was our last pay-per-view, I don't know anymore.
Global domination.
Global domination. Yes, I'm sorry. Wait. Jake just let the pin happen? It's weird decisions here. But as I was saying, Jake had to have the Brotherhood, all the problems in his back of his head. Does he still have that? Because it's not getting any better anytime soon. It's getting worse. If I'm going to be honest, and Jake is still a part of that. Does he still feel like he's a part of that? Does that cloud his judgment in any way?
I wish that, you know, that I could give you an answer, but I'm not sure, and Jake is not sure either, because he got left by Aiden Zinda at Power Struggle, and still he's not reprimanding the Brotherhood. He is still saying there's something good in the Brotherhood, and I think it's a nice detriment of Jake to still have a lot of faith. But Eddie Charisma with the DDT on the apron on Noah Youngblood, and right on the apron spikes.
And it busted Noah Youngblood open right on the top of his head.
Yeah, and this is just incredible. What an incredible triple threat match for the coveted European Championship. And we have seen Eddie be a television champion. we have seen him coming back from injury. And he is just now taunting Noah Youngblood. A lot of frustration is coming out of Eddie Charisma as he goes for the pin. One, two,
Jake sees it.
And oh, Noah is just able to kick out. And you see the face of Eddie. You see that he should have gone for the pin earlier. If he hadn't taunted Noah, he could have been the new European champion.
He could have been, but Noah still kicked out. You cannot keep the champion down just
like that. Oh, and
now
a back suplex right into Eddie Charisma. And Noah Youngblood with the face wash right to the side of the face. And now running, big boot. And Noah Youngblood is
running.
And now a neck breaker on Jake Van Dyke. And oh, Jake now with the leg sweep. And now Jake with the first cover of
really
the matchup.
To the road.
1-2 and a kick out by Noah. Way too
early. He needs to go for that TKO, but does he still think that's the move? The Brotherhood, that's also a part that can play here. Well, looks like it. No count of DDT. You see Eddie Christmas stirring. The rebound knee strike by Noah Youngblood. Is that going to be enough?
Well, Eddie is back on track. Eddie is back on track. What is Eddie going to do here? And now he planted Jake. And Eddie is going to come in just as Noah is going for the pit. And he breaks it up immediately.
Eddie
was waiting. He was waiting for the right time to strike.
Is he
going to
take this?
Is he going to take the victory? He is going to take it. One, two. Hey!
Oh,
we
God.
Have a new European champion! New European champion! Eddie
Charisma!
Eddie Charisma! Eddie Charisma!
Now, you could call this decision by Eddie Charisma questionable, but you cannot deny the outcome. He is the new European champion. Congratulations, Eddie Charisma!
Just as Eddie felt screwed out of the victory at Midsummer Man, screwed out of his return. He returned the favor to Noah Youngblood by screwing him out of his own championship. And this is going to be the biggest sting of all. The biggest sting that Eddie could have delivered to Noah Youngblood. So revenge and a signature move of the DCW was going for that Eddie has certainly delivered. And we have a new DCW European Championship winner. And we will be right back.
Contest is a handicap match. Making his way to the ring
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. I almost forgot that Sonny had a match because he is not a competitor, and neither is his tag team partner, Kelvin. What is this match? This is Make-A-Wish. They say this is a Make-A-Wish charity, and that's why Connor Phillips gets the chance. But Connor Phillips was a legit competitor before he was unnecessarily fired by Sonny, but now... I don't know. It's like the whole world is just turning upside down with Sonny thinking he's a legit competitor. But this is not what you want to see. This is not what you want to see when you're just a board member is being absolutely just pummeled by Connor Phillips, the Make-A-Wish kid, apparently.
He's on the defensive here. He's still got plenty of gas left in his tank.
Connor Phillips shoving it in the face of Sonny. And I see Sonny becoming enraged. He's shouting at him. He's shouting at Connor. But that gives the... No. I wanted to say that gives the chance to Kelvin. But Kelvin has never been in a match before. At least Sonny has been in a few matches. Not successful, mind you. Yeah. Against Connor Phillips. Kelvin here with the pin. Is this gonna be it? That wasn't even a one count. And is Sonny laughing at him? Was Sonny laughing at Kelvin?
Unfortunately for him, there was no water in the pool.
I've seen quite a few insane matches in my time as commentator, but this has to take the cake. Has to be the icing on a very, very large cake. And Connor Phillips just punishing the tag team partner of Sonny Moore. Sonny doesn't seem to care. The only thing he gets enraged by is Connor Phillips throwing it in his face. But he wants the tag now, but Kelvin cannot answer it.
He's stumbling
being stretched
now.
Out now.
He
cannot even get out. It's just being thrown out by Connor. I think
Connor
wants Sonny. Sonny is tagging himself in. I don't know if his friend is going to be happy with that. And Sonny immediately just... oh my god. No. What is going to happen here? Sonny and Calvin both in the same corner. That can display someone's incredible Kelvin is trying.
Never mind.
He's walking away.
He
was trying something, but it didn't work. That's what happens when you just don't have the muscles for this. And the AA, and throwing Kelvin inside the ring as well. Connor Phillips is demolishing these two competitors. No, but a shot. And immediately with the clothesline.
I
mean, I feel sad for Kelvin. He's not a competitor. He didn't even understand why he had to be in this match. He was the secret, the surprise of Sonny. And I don't know what kind of surprise a non-wrestler is. But apparently it's a surprise by Sonny. Maybe it's just punishment. Maybe Sonny just wants to punish Kelvin. Now, Sonny, can he do something? It's only Sonny and Connor. Oh my god! The roll off, the most destructive move in all of professional wrestling! But it's not enough to keep Connor Phillips down. A huge lariat. Kelvin wants in the match, but now Sonny cannot answer. Shoulder block. Oh my, no. No, don't do this, Connor Phillips. I know you want that contract back. I know you want to become a legit wrestler once again. But don't attack this helpless man, Kelvin. Don't attack him. He's not the legal man. Connor, stop it. And a powerbomb into the table. Now again, focusing on Sonny. Sonny again going for it. It's the only thing he can do. But it's countered! Oh my god, it's countered! Oh my god, he just won by a roll-up! The most destructive move! In famous last words, the roll-up! It has beaten Sonny Sapphire. I cannot do anything but laugh at Sonny trying to win by a roll-up to get a count and then lose it. But if I was this board member, I wouldn't be happy at all. Sonny tacked himself in, had the confidence. I don't know where he got that confidence. But look at this, look at the ending. Look at the ending. It's perfect. The one count, and the one count into the tree from Colin Phillips. And that means Colin Phillips is once again a legit member of the UCW roster. This joke of a Make-A-Wish story has come to an end. Sonny has lost, rightfully so. Congratulations to Colin Phillips, and I'm going to take a little break, laugh at the face of Sonny Sapphire, as we going to be back for our next match.
Contest is scheduled for one fall and is for the Extreme Dragon Championship.
To see one of the most competitive matches we've seen in a very long time.
Yes, I'm ready, God.
Alright, here we are, a couple more matches left to go, and this is a very special one. This is the career of the Baphomet, Seitani, on the line. You see him here, and he is going up against the X Division champion. And we are going to see, this could be the final match of Baphomet Seitani, Kel, Ed.
Yeah, my name is Ed.
Yeah, sorry, I was just tagging with Kelvin, so I was screaming his name.
Yeah, how do you feel, Sonny? How do you feel?
I feel good.
Losing to make a wish kid?
Well, that's something that you just have to do, you know? You don't beat your kid at anything. You let them win.
You
let them win. That's what you do with Make-A-Wish.
And
that's
had so much confidence that you tagged yourself in, and you absolutely ruined it.
Well, this is for the X Division Championship, the career of Baphomet against the championship of Daklas. And that's the championship that it is all about, the X Division Championship. The Golden Aura has returned around Daklas at different fast breaking the habit. And here we go, style versus career.
This is gonna be something. Baphomet on his last few legs, because if he loses here, it's over. It's done.
If he can't win the big one here tonight, and then his championship career is over, then his career in UCW is over, and that's a prospect that you don't want for anyone in this business. You want them to stay with the company for as long as possible. But Baphomet is the bringer, is maybe could be the bringer of his own doom.
Close quarters. Yeah, he definitely could be, and he had an amazing run. If you look back at his career, great X Division champion, defeated all comers, including me.
But we just saw a version of the Golden Beast Bomb, and Daklas isn't able to put Baphomet away. He was only able to get a 2 count, and as you said, Baphomet has been an incredible X Division champion. He has brought something to UCW that nobody has ever seen. A demonic side to his character, a demonic side to him as a person, which brought him the X Division Championship, which gave him all those incredible championship defenses on Power Struggle, until the golden roadblock came to him and took his championship away at different paths. And now it is him versus that roadblock.
What a match they had. What
it was an incredible match, an incredible
night.
Yeah, deserving to be in the main event, as Baphomet follows this up with a corner clothesline, and now he might be looking to send his hand across the throat of Daklas, but Daklas isn't getting up. Daklas is having trouble getting back up, Ed.
Well, he's running now.
He had trouble getting up just
and
a
huge clothesline. I didn't realize he had such a glass jaw. Boom, what impact. And another huge clothesline.
And now the Golden Beast is stomping at the challenger. And Daklas would love to retire a third person, because he already retired Dirty Dutch. He retired Jason Whiplash. He would love to add Baphomet to that list.
I mean, at this point, he's just being, well, I don't want to say legend killer, because the people he retired weren't really legends. So, what would you call that? Retirement killer?
The career destroyer.
The career killer, the leader of worlds.
The leader of careers.
The pop-up
and now
pop-up
power bomb by Baphomet. Will he retain his career and gain a championship? No,
so close.
2.5. 2.5. Daklas kicks out. And that would have been incredible that if Daklas would have lost his championship, because that's all that he's been talking about. How he has retained his golden status.
You have to agree with him, because he has reclaimed his golden status. He is once again the X Division champion, one of the greatest X Division champions of our entire history of UCW. And he wants to make another meaningful reign here, and that means retiring Baphomet Seitani here tonight.
Indeed, and now an overhead German superplex, and Baphomet was turned, thrown inside out, I should say, and Dacles is asserting his dominance.
Oh, he's going
and there he goes, and what goes up must come down, the Golden Beast Bomb! The Golden Beast Bomb!
Over,
and at different paths, he needed multiple Golden Beast Bombs to put Baphomet away. So the question now is, will he need only one? But this was a devastating Golden Beast Bomb. And will it be enough? No!
No!
No! No! Baphomet's career is still alive and kicking it, but the pulse is weakening every second that this match goes on.
Yes, but this is not the smartest thing to do, but Dacles showing off to the crowd.
Dacles has an incredible confidence! And now, a South of Heaven chokeslam. A chokeslam by Baphomet. A modified version, I should say, of the chokeslam. Now going into the cover, and a kick out at almost a two, almost a two count, but not completely. The hand of the referee was not down for the two yet, Ed. And as I said, Dacles is very confident in his ability to put Baphomet away.
He is very confident. Of course, he put him away once, but that was one hell of a match, maybe one of the toughest matches Dacles ever had in his career. So it's not going to be that easy, Dacles.
And now a super back suplex by Baphomet. And Baphomet is going to the top, ever getting stronger and stronger. His heartbeat is getting stronger. The heartbeat of his career. And now the frog splash. A frog splash by the satanic cult member Baphomet, and there he goes for the cover and a kick out at two.
Maybe he's tapping into those demon powers that he possesses that nobody else here has ever seen, just a little part of in their lives, but Baphomet somehow embodies it.
Yeah, and Baphomet is gaining strength. He's gaining strength at this moment, Ed. I don't know how he does it, but he is becoming stronger and more vicious as this match goes on. He wants to stay in UCW. He wants his X Division championship back. The championship that means so much to him. The very first and only championship reign he's ever had. And now he got caught by Dacles in midair. And now Dacles with the Golden Tombstone. The Golden Tombstone pile driver in midair. He caught Baphomet like he was a feather, like he weighs nothing at all. And he just tombstoned him. The Golden Tombstone. And it seems like Baphomet is out for the count. Two and three. And Dacles, just like that, puts Baphomet's career in the trap.
What a poetic ending. Ending with a tombstone. It's
has ended the career of Dirty Dutch, Jason Whiplash. And now, here at Famous Last Words, he has ended the career of Dacles. And this could be a recurring theme. If you look at Dacles' resume, how many people will he retire in 2019?
I have no idea. He's had three so far. A move I've never seen by Dacles. I've never seen him do. Golden Pile Driver just like that. It was always the ending, the Golden Beast Bomb. He decided he needed something else. He decided it wouldn't be enough.
No, and it wasn't enough. And he, the struggles he had with the Golden Beast Bomb during that blow, during that break he had in there. And he knew that he needed to do something completely different, something new, something that he could hit out of nowhere. And he saw his opportunity. Caught Baphomet right out of midair, dropped him on his hand with the Golden Pile Driver, and 1, 2, 3 seconds later, and we have a retaining champion and a career.
Congratulations, go out to Dodgers, of course, the Golden Beast retains. What is this? The hearts go out to Baphomet's body. His career is over.
Thank Bob for the incredible matches that he's given. And we wish him best in his future endeavors. Oh, but we are not going to our next match. This is caught backstage, and it's Vinnie Jones seeking out Aiden Sinha and immediately flipping him off behind his back. And what's Vinnie Jones doing? Vinnie Jones with the diamond cutter! The diamond cutter! The diamond cutter!
by Vinnie Jones. New and improved on the floor on Aiden Zinna. And Aiden Zinna knows exactly how those diamond cutters taste. And he tasted a lot of those at Breaking the Habit. Look at the viciousness of Vinnie Jones. And now another diamond cutter on the floor. And again, he flips him off. And it seems like he's walking towards the dressing room of the Brotherhood, where only Jerome Holland remains. And now Jerome Holland is going to feel the wrath of Vinnie Jones.
He is indeed feeling every bit of wrath of Vinnie Jones. Going for those big kicks.
Nasty impact.
Yeah, it seems like Vinnie Jones has unhonestly also been a member of Steam Kick, and now a diamond cutter on Jerome Holland. A diamond cutter on Jerome Holland.
Perhaps a powerbomb here, Corey.
And now, what is Vinnie Jones thinking here?
Now he's going for a powerbomb of his own.
Oh, what a powerbomb right on that corner. And this is becoming more vicious. The vicious side of Vinnie Jones has been unlocked by the carelessness of the Brotherhood. And you can say whatever you want about the Brotherhood, but they have this all to themselves. Through the table, and Vinnie Jones flipping off even more and more. And it seems like Vinnie Jones isn't done yet. He finishes up with a diamond cutter, the new and improved diamond cutter, and flipping us off even more. Vinnie Jones is making a statement here on the behalf of the Brotherhood, on the destruction of his old teammates. And we're going to go ahead with this steel cage match.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Asriel versus Dylan Mason. And Dylan Mason was taunting Asriel in the early going. And Asriel is leaving no prisoners here in this steel cage matchup, Ed. What do you think of this match?
I quite frankly don't know what to think. This is a blood feud at its worst. I mean, Mason injured Asriel after Asriel became the number one contender for the World Heavyweight Championship. And he was out for a good few weeks to a month. His friend tried to get revenge and it failed, or at least it didn't go as planned.
You could say that again.
Here tonight, the number one contendership is on the line. That's what Asriel put on the line to have this match with Dylan Mason inside a steel structure. It's just incredible.
Yeah, and that is just what you said is absolutely true. Last month at Global Domination, we saw Galki, the best friend of Asriel and his tag team partner in the Three Beautiful Sunshines, take on Dylan Mason as form of revenge. And we saw a side of Galki that we haven't seen since his time in the Primetime Punishment, that we haven't seen for such a long time. And now a combination of kicks and strikes and ending it with a leg sweep by Dylan Mason. And now a jawbreaker by Asriel. And they haven't slowed down an inch, Ed, since they started this matchup. And now a flapjack by Asriel.
That is the blood, just the pure bloodlust of both these competitors. Because Asriel is not an aggressive person, but We are seeing a different side of him.
This is an Asriel that I have never seen. So focused, so determined. And another flapjack on Dylan Mason. So determined to win this match, to retain his number one contendership rights. And it seems like Asriel is thinking of climbing out of the cage. Yes, there he goes.
Yes, he's going for it.
He is going to try and climb out of the cage.
Mason is standing up.
And Mason is just looking.
He's waiting.
He's just looking. He's looking at it. And what is Asriel? Standing on the cage with the high cross body right on awaiting Dylan Mason. It's just like it's like Dylan Mason has some kind of power over Asriel.
It seems he is holding something over his head, and it's just wow.
And now a jumping knee strike by Dylan Mason and a kick out at one by Asriel. And I'm not sure about the game plan of Dylan Mason, but when are we ever sure about the game plan of Dylan Mason, Ed?
No, but it seems like Mason already knew that he wasn't going to escape.
It seems like Dylan Mason just glared at Asriel, and Asriel saw him in the corner of his eye and decided that he needed to take Dylan Mason down.
Exactly. And that's what I mean with this hatred towards each other. And understandably so.
Yeah, very understandable. And an elbow drop, we just saw a top rope Frankensteiner by Asriel. And now Asriel
is he gonna go for it another time?
To try and escape once more.
Yes, he is.
This time Dylan is still on his back, but Dylan is showing signs of
staggering
life.
Now.
This time, and Asriel is trying to look if he can go over the edge. Damn,
that is difficult.
And Dylan Mason trying to go towards him now. And now Dylan Mason is stopping Asriel from going out of the cage. And now it seems like Asriel is groggy.
What?
And it seems like Dylan Mason is going to join him on the cage. Ed, it seems like Dylan is looking for it.
He is indeed. He's going to climb up with him.
And there he is. There they
are.
Sitting.
And
just staring.
Again.
And Asriel is turning his back. He's turning his back towards Dylan Mason.
this difference helps me cross the line. Every time I'm confronted, I'm unafflicted by my actions. Is the result of a game. Victory at the cost of pain. Like a freight train, you're tied to the tracks. No way to escape, there's no coming back. You're in my way, and I haven't got the time today. Best you walk away, and if you fight another day. Nothing personal, I just don't care. Won't bother explaining, it goes nowhere. Just know tomorrow won't come if I end things today. Suffering is the result of a game. Victory at the cost of pain. Like a freight train, you're tied to the tracks. No way to.
This is
nice.
Shut it down. Here we go with this huge triple.
Nailed it.
All right. Here we are. We are back. We had some little technical difficulties, Ed, but we are back with this triple threat Hell in a Cell match for the World Heavyweight Championship. Conor Boyd versus AK-47 Giel versus Marcus Fenix. And of course, this stipulation was chosen by AK-47 Giel after winning the first ever UCW Beat the Clock Challenge. And now we see a lariat by Conor
by
Boyd.
Beating Ray Austin.
In 32 seconds with a roll up. The most devastating move in all of UCW.
Oh, damn. Yeah, that roll up, you know. I think I need to have that in my arsenal. That way I can win some matches again. I mean, I just won a match, but still.
Yeah, let's not forget that you just won a match. Of course, Marcus Fenix is the most dangerous competitor, and he is going for not one, a double choke slam. Incredible, Ed. Incredible strength.
I think that's the first time I've ever seen that being applied here at UCW.
Yeah, you aren't the only one. I think this is the first time that I've ever seen a double chokeslam in UCW. And Conor kicks out at one. And this is still, of course, early on in this matchup.
And now going for the cover on Giel.
The referee taking their time. And a one, a two.
That's a two count.
Oh, and Giel just able to kick out. Just able to kick out.
Look at the big man, Mark Phoenix. Now he's down. We got a boy with some rights to the face. This match inside Hell in a Cell. Of course, we just had the steal already. So, but this is a bit, bigger
cage. This is a cage that you can't get out of the ring. This
you're
is some,
trapped
this is,
there.
This is, you're trapped. Yes, you aren't able to escape. You can't win by escaping. You technically can escape, but
well, you can try and escape. Maybe climb. And have a little bone saw.
And now Giel threw Marcus Phoenix right in front of the Wolves. But it, no, Giel doesn't want Connor to focus on Marcus. He wants
and
Connor
Marcus
all to himself.
Both these competitors want Connor for themselves.
Yeah, they both want to be able to pin the World Heavyweight Champion as Connor's head is repeatedly thrusted into the top turnbuckle. And now Marcus Phoenix going for another cover on Connor. One. Two and a kick out.
Now, Connor, Marcus Phoenix and Giel having a little bit of a brawl here now. Connor on the ground. And just the mass, the total mass of the body is just enough to knock Giel down. And I'm not surprised. I mean, that would knock anybody down.
It really would. It really would, Ed. And now a bulldog by Connor Boyd from the blind spot of Marcus Phoenix. And now Marcus rolls out of the ring. The biggest man in this match has been taken out for the duration of the match right now. We haven't seen... He won't be in the ring right now. So this is the time that Connor and Giel can spend trying to hopefully take the other one down. And now with a big, big superplex and a two count and just a nick of time, Giel gets his left shoulder up. But will it be? And now, and that's all the time that Connor and Giel got with the two of them because Marcus is back and he is bigger than ever with a belly to belly suplex.
He's bigger than ever. Did he grow in size?
I don't know how he does it, Ed. I don't know how he does it. He still does it. And oh, Giel again just able to get that the right shoulder up this time. And Connor has rolled out of the ring. He's even rolled out of view. We don't know where the world champion is with a back elbow by Marcus Phoenix.
Yes, we can. He's back on his feet.
Yes, we can. How very Obama of you.
Oh, God.
And now a suplex back into the ring. And Connor Boyd's on the top rope. And Marcus doesn't see him. And a grappling blow right to the back of the head of Marcus. And those are the kinds of strikes that Connor needs to use against people like Marcus. From the blind spots. Such that you can't prepare for. That you don't see coming are the most devastating shots. And now,
eyes of Connor.
Yes, a thumb to the eye. And now Giel taking control of this matchup.
But Marcus is already on his feet. And that means you're in trouble, Giel. Doesn't matter that you're in control now. He's not going to be in control for long.
And the running big boot. He almost boots Giel out of existence. And now Marcus with the Connor on Connor. The cover on Connor. Jesus.
The Connor on Connor?
Say that five times in a row.
I'm not going to do that.
And now Connor throws Marcus Phoenix on the apron. And now he goes to the outside of the ring. And again, he's looking for that blind spot. Very smart and effective strategy used by Connor Boyd. As he has
now,
never been this dominant.
Finally, the Hell in a Cell gets into play by... Oh my God, the power! Oh my God!
Oh, the power by Giel, and he just power slams the biggest man in UCW through the biggest cell in the world.
That's a lot of biggest.
Yes.
Now they're fighting outside, so no escape. Well, there is escape because they're outside now.
Marcus is escaping to the top of the cell, and Connor shows no fear in following. And Giel is debating on the outside if he should follow or not.
This is smart.
Should I go up there? The smart choice would be no. And if Giel is smart, he won't, but he needs to go. He wants to inflict punishment, and he wants to be there to make the final cover of this match.
And Marcus Phoenix
he
is choking out Connor's life, and Connor's lifeless. Maybe he just killed him.
There is heel. But of course, we need to. Oh, the DDT right on the cell. And the cell buckled just a little bit, Ed.
I saw a dent. I saw a dent.
Well, of course, if Marcus Phoenix goes down on the cell, of course, there's going to be a dent. And Marcus Phoenix now with Gil in the powerbomb position. And he's walking to the edge of the cell. Walking to the edge of the cell. And he is teasing. He's teasing, dropping the lifeless body.
He is teasing.
Look at him. The power of Marcus is incredible. And the second time around, again teasing us with another power bomb. And he's just playing with Phil as his point. And Connor, he is just enjoying this. Connor must be enjoying this. And now
and
a third power bomb on the edge of the
Connor
of
is
the cell.
Done for it.
And now Connor comes running in with the knee strike. And again, the blind spot. Marcus didn't see it coming. And Connor has an effective strategy and is now going to be a copycat.
He's got a copycat.
And, he's
going to
copy what Marcus did. And is this going to be one of those anything you can do, I can do better at?
Well, yeah, but Marcus is not having it at all.
Yeah, but now... Oh, and just suplex throws it to the corner, and now a bulldog. And we see another dent on the cell, Ed. And now again the powerbomb position as Connor is staggering to his feet.
Oh, and God, again going... Oh my God!
Oh my God, Gil! He is powerbombed right through the announce tables! Both announce tables have just been destroyed by the impact of AK-47 Gil, Ed. And... Is Gil alive?
Gil, are you alive?
We need some medical. We need medical attention. No. Stay there. Not... Gil is on his feet. The adrenaline that must be flowing through the system of Gil.
Oh, it's going to hurt tomorrow. Believe me,
it's not only going to hurt tomorrow. It's going to hurt in 2020.
Through his life. Yeah. It's not going to be the end, but this adrenaline that he has.
Later, when Gil is talking to his grandchildren, and those grandchildren are going to ask, Grandpa, why are you in such pain all the time? He is going to put on this match, and he's going to say, famous Let's Wars 2019, kids, you better all remember what your grandfather went through back then. The scars of UCW are going to be shown. Throughout
it's
his
a
lifetime.
Nice look in the future of the life of Gil with his grandchildren.
Well, I'm going to assume that he is going to shoot the loads like a true AK-47.
Oh my God!
Oh my God, Marcus Phoenix! And there is nothing to cushion the fall of Marcus Phoenix because Gil had already broke the tables. And now, Connor Boyd with Gil.
No!
Power bombs him through the ring, through the cell. And Marcus is decapitated on the outside of the ring. And it looks like Connor is all alone. What beautiful strategy by the no-nonsense knockout artist. And Marcus, is he okay? That's the question
that we all need.
Look at him. He seems dizzy. He seems to not know where he is. And in the ring, we see the knee is trembling. There it is, the knee strike. The knee strike by Connor Boyd.
What is Marcus? He needs to go. He needs
to get back in. And there he goes. Connor with the pinfall, the two. And Gil is just able to get
after
that shoulder.
After all that. After being thrown off the cell, through the cell.
And now the knee's trembling again. Another running knee strike into the cover. And there's Marcus Phoenix to break it up. And Connor must have thought that he was done. But there it is, the tombstone! The tombstone by Marcus Phoenix. That devastating tombstone that he hit Connor with. If you remember, at different paths, breaking the habit after they briefly won the tag team titles. He hit them with the same tombstone.
There he goes,
we have a new champion!
No,
just a kick out of 2.5.
This is insane. Just pure insanity.
And now Gil has also, and now look at them both going at Connor Boyd, but those big forearms Of Barkas also took out Giel. And now Connor, with both of them, sends Giel into Barkas. And now they are both down. And Giel smartly is focusing on getting out of the ring, not being able to get pinned. And now the cover on Marcus. And Marcus able to kick out at two, Ed. How barely, do you feel about this match?
Barely getting the shoulder up. How I feel about this match, this is awesome, but it's also scary for the competitors inside this match because two of them have been thrown off the cell as another knee strike hits.
And Connor is signaling at Marcus, come up, get up, get up. I need to finish you off. He wants that pinfall over Marcus Fenix more than anything. And now Giel comes in and a double underhooks into the double knees. And now the thrust kick by Connor Boyd. And now a drop kick, but Giel is able to evade it. And look at the face. A mask of blood on Giel.
I mean, he has the most pain in this match. I mean, thrown out the cell, through the cell. Two knee strikes to his face and another big boot just to complete it all.
Yeah, and
Connor
now
going through the pin.
One, two, and Marcus Fenix breaking it up. And we were just waiting for him to break it up.
We were indeed waiting for him to break it up. What else can these guys do?
Yeah, and Giel is showing the signs of this Hell in a Cell match. And now a flying forearm off the top rope by Marcus Fenix. And Marcus Fenix rolls out of the ring. And this could be the moment for Giel or Connor to finish one another off. There is so much history between Giel and Connor. The struggle to be the leader of the Dutch Death Squad when the first iteration hit. When Giel, Dacless, and Alex Mercury left United States Championship Wrestling. They left it. They left Connor. And he has been able to surge to the top of the mountain. And now Giel is trying to make that his spot in UCW, Ed.
He is. He thinks it's time for him to finally get that big, big gold around his waist. But he has a problem, and it's a big problem. In Marcus Fenix.
Oh, the jumping knee.
The top rope.
Jumping knee strike. And now, big boot countering. And now trying to go for a belly to belly, but Giel able to counter it as well. The counter city here. And now a clothesline by Marcus Fenix.
Connor needs to get up,
and
he gets
it seems
up.
Like,
this is the end.
The pump kick. The pump kick. Will it be enough? No, Connor is back in the ring, and that means that Connor is able to break up that pinfall. And now a Lou Fast Press taking out the big guy. And you can see the wear and tear that it also has on Marcus Fenix. He isn't invincible, but he is damn almost invincible. And now the backbreaker into the Russian leg sweep combo by Connor Boyd that we've seen him utilize in a lot of matches.
Again, going for the Lou Fast Press. Yes. I mean, Giel already can't see anymore. That's how bad the blood has gotten to his, into his eyes.
Yeah, now the non-nonsense artist going to the top rope. Again, that flying four that he also utilized on Marcus Fenix tonight.
Marcus has...
And now the drop kick.
Marcus is back in the ring, looking at Connor. Connor counters him. And a big.
And now another drop kick, and Marcus falls on Giel, and Connor now has them both for the picking. Who is it gonna be? Discus forearm nailing Marcus, and it seems like Marcus might be out for the first time in his career. And then the suplex into the cross arm breaker. And will he make Giel tap like he did with Dylan? Yes! Giel taps out to the cross arm breaker, and Connor Boyd retains his UCW World Heavyweight Championship ad.
That means we know the main events of Civil Wars.
Yes, it will be Connor Boyd versus Dylan Mason. The match we thought that we would never see. Because every time it looked like we were going to see that match, something came up, someone interfered, or it became a triple threat. But now, at Civil Wars, the main event will be Connor Boyd one-on-one with Dylan Mason. And that's going to be one incredible main event, Ed.
This match was already incredible. I mean, Connor put so much pain on his opponents. This is a champion. This is a champion.
Yes, and holding that is exactly the gold up. He is the UCW World Heavyweight Championship holder, Connor Boyd. And with that, we are going to end this broadcast of Famous Last Words. My name has been Sunny Sapphire. With me, as always, at Ultimo. We thank you very much for watching. And we will see you next time at Civil Wars.